Hi, it's Wallace Cunningham, and you are listening to U.S. Modernist Radio.
Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Oh, I don't care what mama don't allow, gonna draw mine modern anyhow. Mama don't allow no architecture around here.
Welcome to U.S. Modernist Radio, where we talk and laugh with people who enjoy, own, create, dream about, preserve, love, and hate modernist architecture, the most exciting and controversial buildings in the world. I'm Tom Guild. The 2024 Architecture and Design Film Festival, or ADFF, starts up next week in New York. This long-running series is led by returning podcast guest Kyle Bergman, who founded the ADFF in New York in 2008 and hosts versions of it all over the world. ADFF seeks out films with impassioned human stories that appeal to both architects and the general design-loving public. Today, we'll talk with filmmakers who've shown at ADFF, including Sabine Gisger, Beatrice Minger, and Mario Novas. Plus, we'll talk with Kyle about the highlights for 2024. Finally, a very special musical guest, Lucie Arnaz. And now, here's your host, Mr. Modernism, George Smart.
Hey, thanks, Tom. I've had the privilege of participating in some of these architecture documentaries. Two films by Jake Gorst, Frey II and New England Modernism, a PBS documentary on North Carolina modernist architecture, and my personal favorite so far, When Giants Walked Here. I can say with pretty much certainty it's the first documentary to combine modernist architecture with pro wrestling. Dorton Arena in Raleigh, North Carolina was built in the early 50s, a stunning hyperbolic paraboloid facility that is part of the North Carolina State Fairgrounds. Designed by Matthew Nowitzki, the structure has stood the test of time and is intensely loved by the Raleigh public. One of the reasons why is that the pro wrestling circuit was there for decades,
yep,
slamming and jamming on the weekends in front of thousands of fans. Decades before John Cena, The Rock, and Triple H, Dorton Arena had wrestlers like Bearcat Wright, Wahoo McDaniel, Paul Jones, Roddy Piper, The Destroyer, and of course, the great Ric Flair. Every Saturday night, Dorton was high-concept architecture embracing a populist sport that many fans wish would come back to Raleigh. Produced by Cliff Bumgardner and Chris Lee, you can view When Giants Walked Here on PBS. You can tell your friends you're watching it for the architecture, just like reading Playboy for the articles. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by June Goldfinger and Jeff Taylor, sponsors of Circle, Square, Triangle, a traveling exhibition on the architecture of Myron Goldfinger, and by Diane Bald and the Budman family, restoring significant architecture in Toronto, Los Angeles, Malibu, and Palm Springs.
Swiss filmmaker Sabine Gisger is the writer and director of documentaries Do It, Gambit, Yalom's Cure, and Guru. After an early career as a TV journalist in Switzerland, she pivoted into documentary filmmaking, diving into unconventional subjects and controversial topics. Her latest film, The Mies van der Rohe, explores modernism through the eyes of the women who both had to put up with Mies van der Rohe and deal with his absence when he left the family behind to come to America. Unlike every other documentary which focuses on his architecture, you'll hear the perspective of Mies' wife, Ada, his three daughters, Georgia, Marianne, and Waltraut, and his partner, Lily Reich. Here's George's conversation with Sabine Gisger.
Before we talk about your film, The Mies van der Rohe, let's talk about your dissertation in school. You wrote about the history of maids. Tell me about that.
That was my PhD, actually. I studied history at the University of Zurich and Pisa. My grandmom was a maiden, and I knew many other older ladies who had started their lives after school by being maiden. And I thought it's so very interesting. And at that time, I understood there is really a big difference between history and her story.
Yes.
Studying history and not her story, I felt like doing some her story myself. Actually, when I proposed to the professor, he said that this is no theme. That was beginning of the 80s. So I really had to fight that I could even do it. But in the end, yes, it was my PhD. And it was so interesting to tell history or her story from a different perspective to complete, in a way, the picture. I think with you to history, to always rewrite it. And that's what I did all my life. After that PhD, I changed to filmmaking, but all my films are in a historical context.
I think they're in a historical context.
In a historical context,
yeah,
you're right.
Right. Certainly, this film, The Mies van der Rohe, is that. It's one of the most unusual documentaries that I've seen. It's really fascinating, talking about the stories of the women involved. I have met Dirk Lohan, who is the grandson of Mies van der Rohe. And Mies visited our town, Raleigh, North Carolina, in the 50s, when one of our significant buildings was going up, Dorton Arena. But your film really gets into the stories of this universe that Mies created. And there was some good in it, of course, but it was not a pleasant time for a lot of the people involved. So how did you get attracted to Mies as a subject matter and the women that were in his universe?
Not that Mies attracted me as a subject matter. I'm interested in modernism, so I'm in the right radio here, I guess.
Yes.
And when I found the autobiography of Georgia van der Rohe, of his eldest daughter, I read it and I thought, wow, that's a completely different view on things that I had before. So I thought I must absolutely go and talk to this old lady. And then I missed the time and she died. So, okay, I left it there, but I could never leave the idea to make a film about all that. So I started to do research. I came to Chicago to see Dirk Lohan, and he told me, listen, my sister Ulrike, she has all that stuff. If there is anything, she has it. And then I went to Munich, where she lives, and she actually had letters, photographs, diaries of Ada, the wife of Mies. And there it really started to interest me, because I saw firsthand, I could read and understand the feelings and the thoughts of these women around Mies. And that was interesting for me.
What was it like for these women at that time?
There was, of course, at the beginning of the last century, a movement of women, of bourgeois women of the higher classes, to get some kind of independence. They started to say that they wouldn't put on all these terrible clothes, that they started to organize, to fight for the right to vote, as you know. But nevertheless, it was all open. It was not clear at the beginning of the last century how to live, how to love, because everything was changing. The old world of the 19th century was gone in a way, but it was like an open space, how to move in that space. And they tried to take some liberties. They tried to educate their daughters like Ada did. The wife of Mies, for her, it was very important to educate the daughter, things that were impossible before. So they were struggling, let's say.
In your film, you use a hybrid approach of talking about the subject matter as well as having actors who portray the different people in it. That, of course, has been a strategy in many, many documentaries, but very few architecture documentaries that I've seen. I've only seen one other film that use actors to help tell the story. And you use German actress Katerina Thalbach to portray Georgia. How did you find her, and why was she good for the role?
I knew that I wanted somebody, an actress from Berlin, because Georgia van der Rohe was from Berlin, and it just seemed right to me. And then I was looking around, and then I saw her in a film, and I just felt that's her. And I wrote to her, and she read my script, and she was immediately enthusiastic, and she could feel that story and loved to do it. It's actually, her role is to play Georgia van der Rohe, who is getting interviewed. So it's not a reenactment of scenes in a way, but it's a reenactment of an interview that I would have liked to do and didn't do. All the answers she gives, the actress, they are all meticulously authentic from writings of Georgia. And I invented only the question of the filmmaker.
I thought it was unusual that
Mies and other architects of that era left to come to America and left their families behind. Why was that?
I mean, he saw that under the Nazis, he couldn't go on with building. He tried, but it was not that he said, I won't build for them. He tried, but they wouldn't let him because they were against modernism, of course. They liked the more classical, pompous kind of architecture. And so when he got that invitation to the U.S., he took it, and he was already away from the family long before. He was just caring for himself. He was not caring for politics. He was not caring for family. He was caring for architecture.
How did Ada inspire her daughters to live interesting lives and discover themselves?
Ada suffered a lot from her childhood. She had a father who was beating the mother, and really she had bad experiences, and she suffered depression. And she thought that with that big love to Mies, that would be her liberation from that kind of mood and sufferance. But as then Mies left her, she felt back in a big hole, but she managed for the sake of her daughters to come out of it. She did very early psychotherapy, different therapies, came out of it. And then she decided that she has to do everything to give a good education to the daughters, to make them love liberty, to make them love nature. So she was a very engaged mother.
Do you think that the women in Mies' life influenced his architecture?
Lili Reich, sure. Lili Reich was his companion since, 1927. I'm not quite sure now, but around that, they worked together. And that's also the moment where Mies started to do furniture. He didn't do that before. Lili Reich did that too before. She taught him about materials and colors. And so they had a big collaboration. So she influenced him, sure enough, a lot.
And what happened to Lili Reich?
When Mies went away, he left her back. But in 1939, she went there to visit him. Actually, she hoped that she could stay in U.S. with him, but he sent her back. He said that there is so many tribunal processes. Is that a word? That they had to go in court.
Oh, administrative processes.
Yes, for the rights of the Bauhaus furniture and stuff. And he wanted her to go back to look for the office. She did that, and she was very unhappy about it. And she felt that her own creativity would go to hell if she only has to do these things. That's what she also wrote to him. We can find her letter in the Library of Congress. Yeah, it was quite sad. And then during the war, her apartment was completely bombed. That means that we don't have a lot of letters and stuff and designs of her. We have some designs that she sent to Mies before the war, and that in the end now are at the MoMA. But we have not many things from her to reconstruct her thoughts and feelings. And after the war, I think in 46 or 47, she died.
And Mies died in, what, the late 60s, I recall?
Yes.
How is Mies' legacy affected by these important women that were in his life?
His legacy wasn't affected at all because nobody did talk about these women. And Lili Reich wasn't even really in the mind of historiography. That changed now.
Yes.
There is research all over the place, also in Barcelona. There is one picture of Lili Reich at the opening of the famous Barcelona pavilion, but you see only the shadow on the floor.
Oh, really?
No photo, yeah. It's always Mies the king and Mies with her, and from Lili Reich, only one shadow. And to me, it felt always like a very symptomatic picture.
Certainly, he was a big personality and subsumed everything around him.
Yeah, but he was not the only man of his generation who did so.
Yes.
It was not something that anybody thought about or anybody thought that it was wrong. Not even the women around him. Mm. That came later.
Where can people see this film? Is it streaming anywhere or available through a website?
Through Architecture and Design Film Festival.
Okay.
You know the festival?
Yes. Kyle Bergman.
Kyle Bergman. There you can download the film.
Okay, great. Well, thank you so much for talking with me, Sabine. This has been a pleasure, and I loved your movie.
That's so nice. Thank you very, very much.
That was George talking with Sabine Gisger. Eileen Gray was an Irish architect with no formal training, who became a pioneer of the modern movement in architecture. Over her career, she was associated with many notable European artists of her era, including Kathleen Scott, Adrian Gorska, Le Corbusier, and John Badovici, with whom she was romantically involved. Beatrice Minger is a writer and director based in Zurich, producing short films Love a Little and I Feel More Like a Stranger. Her latest project is the full-length documentary E1027, Eileen Gray and House by the Sea, an exploration of the Irish designer's 1929 avant-garde masterpiece on the Côte d'Azur. Here's George's conversation with Beatrice Minger.
Beatrice, thank you so much for joining me. I really loved your film.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
I know that films that are documentaries that have live action people in them have been around for a long time, but very few of them for architecture documentaries. This is one of the first ones I've seen where you're reenacting part of someone's life to help tell the story. How did you choose to do that?
So it became apparent actually quite early on in the project that we weren't setting out to make like a more classical documentary with a lot of talking heads, experts of Eileen Gray or Le Corbusier talking about her work. Because this film already exists, Gray Matters, I believe it's 2016 it came out, and it's really a great film, and you have all the information that you need there. So we knew from the beginning that we didn't want to go like in a classical documentary way. And also there's already a fiction film, a biopic called Price of Desire. So this has already been done. And we were trying to find a new approach to tell not only this story about the house that is in the center of the film, but also we were interested in finding a form that could be very immersive so we can really try to understand Eileen Gray's perspective on this whole story. And also there are no relatives left. All the protagonists are long dead. There are no relatives, so there's nobody to interview either. So it became clear that it could be interesting to work with actors and different spaces and to bring together like different means of filmmaking and try to find a hybrid form that could actually also maybe relate to Eileen Gray's work. Because as you know, she is a brilliant artist. Whatever she did, she always invented a new form. She always crossed boundaries. She never did what anybody else did. She always tried something new. So we dared to get inspired by that and found a way to do it with actors, yes, and reenactment. Although, I mean, I have to say reenactment is also a very broad term. It can be done very literally, like one-on-one actors just really reenact what we think they did or how they had a conversation. And we wanted to find a little bit a different way where it's it wasn't so much about representation of the characters, but more like try to find this inner perspective, especially of her, of the main protagonist of this incredible artist.
A lot of your film is set in her famous house, E1027, and you have your actor playing her walking around, really experiencing the house. So how did you get access to this house?
Actually, we were really lucky that we contacted the people from the museum while it was still being renovated. It was finished in 2021. And we actually also were there to film a little bit of the renovation work. And we kind of just built up a relationship with them because it also, for me and also for the cameraman, the DP, Ramon Giger, it was really important also to spend as much time in this house that was possible, because we knew as soon as it will become a museum, it is open to the public, and they, of course, have many, many visitors over each day, so not so much time to spend for us there without being disturbed. And we were actually lucky to be just at the right time to have that opportunity to be there in the house. And also, the museum was really, really incredible with helping us in every way they could to turn this house from a museum also into a house that Eileen Gray could actually live in. While we really had to be very, very careful not to bump into any furniture and not to make any scratches, you know, they were really helpful and trying to do everything they could to help us film there actually with the actress, which is, I think, invaluable for the film, because Eileen Gray is all about experiencing architecture. It's not just about looking at it. She says at one point, it's not just finding forms and lines that look good, but it's all about creating a dwelling for people. And to experience this, we really needed to be in there with the actress.
She was a successful artist and sculptor, I believe, for the early part of her life, and only took up architecture around 1921, where she would have been in her 40s. That's quite late for anybody.
Right. I mean, she was really like, what do you call a trailblazer? I feel like whenever she did something, like she picked up lacquer work, she had to invent a new color in lacquer, you know, or she started to make furniture, then she worked with different material, lighter material. She really always was kind of cutting edges and transgressing boundaries, whatever she did. And I think architecture for her, as soon as she's really started to design whole spaces, for me, it's really for her a development from the small thing or the furniture piece that is like something that is around you or surrounds the body. And she like transcended to and became always bigger. From spaces, she redesigned an apartment. And the next step was really for her to build her own house and really realize her own vision of modern architecture that was a little bit different from what was done at the time.
This is her most famous home, of course. She also designed another house in 1961 in Saint-Tropez. Did you get to visit that one?
No, unfortunately, that is not really what it was used to be. It was very much renovated. It has a pool in the garden. And we tried to get in touch with the people who lived there, but they didn't want to have anything to do with the film or with Eileen Gray. So they weren't interested. Mm. So unfortunately, no. But on the internet, it was on sale at one point when we started filming, and that's where we tried to get in. But you can see that it had nothing to do with the little house she renovated.
What did you want your audience to understand about Eileen Gray from filming at the house and having an actor portray her?
For me, it was from the very early on, it was very much about how did she experience spaces? Because we don't know that much from Eileen Gray. As you might know, she destroyed a lot of her documents before she died, or let her niece, Prunella Clough, destroy a lot of the documents before she died. So a lot of the things we can only assume, but from my broad research and all the talks that I have, is like I learned that she has a very particular relationship with space. So it's almost an animistic idea of everything, like the human body being connected very much to the surrounding, to the environment, as that a philosophical aesthetics would think of a space. And to me, it was always interesting to really understand what it was to her that makes a space, and then also transform this experience into a film where we also can have the audience experience how she perceived a space, but then also how it was violated and transgressed. Like, what does it really mean to be pushed out of a space by Le Corbusier, of course? So I was trying to find a form that can have the audience experience this violation of her room. That is also why we turn to means that we try to rebuild spaces in a studio that is edited together with the house to really also put the focus and the emphasis on the idea of space, of the idea of human and social spaces. Also for an artist, for that space to be invaded. And for her, it was very, very personal with what Le Corbusier did, of course.
So how did that come about with Le Corbusier? Because my understanding is that Eileen Gray and a man she was with, Jean Badovici, is that how you pronounce his name?
Yeah, I think Badovici.
Badovici.
Yeah.
That they broke up after the house was completed and that he stayed on in the house. So how did Corbusier come into the picture?
Jean Badovici was the publisher of this magazine, L'Architecture Vivante, which is one of the main modernist magazines in the early 20s for modernist movement in France. He was friends with Le Corbusier because I think he did 7 issues about Le Corbusier's work in L'Architecture Vivante. So they were friends, and Le Corbusier at some point visited E1027. While he visited and came back many times, he developed along with it the idea that modern architecture, there needs to be blank spaces, plain walls. First, they were all white, then they became like monochromic with colors. And in the beginning, Le Corbusier was all about like no decorations, you know. This was his manifest that there could be no decorations in the house. But before the war, actually, Second World War, he started to play with the idea of actually painting the walls. And in E1027, he found the perfect canvas for his paintings. He came to the house through Jean Badovici. In the end, it was also Jean Badovici who let him paint the murals. And she didn't know about all that at all. And she only learned after the war out of a magazine and became very cross with the two guys.
Sure. And Corbusier built houses nearby and died in 1965?
Yes. So you could think of what Le Corbusier did is actually really not just appropriation of the house, but also of the whole plot. Because behind the house, just 20 meters behind the house, there was this little bistrot, L'Étoile de Mer. And he also befriended this guy who had the bistrot and built his Le Cabanon, I'm sure you know it, just right behind the wall. It's just a couple of steps away of E1027. So kind of overlooking the whole plot of land and also getting control over it once Jean Badovici died. He tried to get a buyer for the house because he was very concerned that somebody could buy the house and make something with it that he was not in control of. At one point, he wanted to make a museum out of it, but wasn't so concerned about the house, but more, of course, of his to preserve the murals that he painted. And he controlled the whole plot. And in a way, he still does, because the little road leading up to the house is called Chemin Le Corbusier. And he is still a very, very like larger than life figure, of course, in this plot of land, because also, yes, he died there. He died actually swimming in the ocean in 1965, yes.
Corbusier overshadowed Eileen Gray for all the years that he was alive. And it was only really in the last 15, 20 years of her life that people found out about her and her contributions. Were you able to find any video or audio recordings of her to help inform the performance of your actor on the film?
Yeah, there is one piece of video that is actually also in the film that you will find in the end of the film. That is the only piece of video that we know of It's a film in Irish TV about lacquer work, and they actually interviewed her about lacquer work. And then there's another taped interview by Andrew Hodgkinson. He was an art student in London and found out about her and made an interview with Eileen Gray. Mm-hmm. And he was so nice to have us let these recordings too. So in the end, we will have this one piece of video and then this one piece of audio. That is the only two pieces of documents that we know of, because she really made sure that no like private documents survive from her. So in her last years, she actually collected two portfolios with her work that are beautifully done. And because she did all her photographs herself and she put together a portfolio of her work, and this is what she wanted to preserve for future generations and not her private life. She was a very, very private person, as you know.
Where can people see the film?
Currently, it's showing in festivals in Europe. We're going to Munich, and then there will be more festivals in Europe. Hopefully, we'll pick up in one of the festivals in the US, too. That would be amazing, of course. And it will most probably come out in theaters in November. Okay. In Switzerland, but also Germany so far, and maybe a French release, but that is still unclear.
And then does it go to a streaming service after that?
It's possible, but we don't know yet.
Okay.
We hope for it because, we really want to make it accessible for a very broad audience everywhere, but it's still too early to say.
Eileen Gray is a fascinating architect that people should know more about. Thank you so much for talking with me.
Thank you. Thanks for the talk.
George was talking with Beatrice Minger. Journalist Kate Kliwadenko and architect Mario Novas are the duo behind the content creation company Kliwadenko Novas, or KN, a production company focused on architecture, art, city, and branding. KN has produced multiple docuseries, including Mexity and Architecture on the Edge for Australia's Shelter streaming service. Their latest project for Shelter is Here Are the Architects, a series that highlights the work of four female architects working internationally out of Mexico. George recently spoke with Mario Novas via Zoom.
Mario, let's start with telling me where you are. Where do you live?
I'm living in Chile, in the southern part of Chile. Actually, it's the entrance door to the Patagonia. It's a small city called Valdivia, although I'm from Spain. But my wife and also my partner, Katerina Kliwadenko, she is Chilean. So that's the reason we both are here.
You couldn't pick a more beautiful place to capture architecture, could you?
I don't know if this place is known for its architecture, but it's really known because of this really awesome natural surroundings. That's the main part of it. Valdivia is actually the city who has registered the highest earthquake since earthquakes are being registered with this Richter scale.
Yes, the Richter scale, so, right.
Yeah. So the earthquake happened here in 1960, and it was above 9.0.
Oh, that's a big one.
That's a big one, yes. So it destroyed completely the city, and in the 60s, they thought, let's build something for now, and then we fix it later. But apparently, we never fixed it later, so now it stays as it was. We lost this nice city they built it before the earthquake.
You have been developing some wonderful documentaries, which are on Australia's Shelter streaming service. The first of those was called Mexity. What's that about?
Mexity is actually our portrait of what's going on with architecture in a country like Mexico. And Mexico has this huge city, which is the city of Mexico. And what we wanted to know is where architects are trying to push the boundaries of what we think about architecture, which is usually related to an architect and a client asking you for his personal house. And therefore, we made this documentary that is called Mexity, and it tries to portray architecture through four different verticals, which are social buildings, public space, new industries, which are now in the city. We need industries in the city. The fourth one was how we can rehab old spaces. So it's about rehabilitation.
Someone says in the film that in Mexico City, here we risk. So what are some of the risks they are taking in Mexico City?
They are taking many risks because Mexico, we found out, is a country that invests a lot of public funds in good architecture. And the way they invested with new architects, and most of them are even quite young. And they all try to stand out and try to push architecture to new shapes, new way of getting linked again with the society. And that's the way I think he refers to the risk they take.
What risky kind of moves did you observe in making the film?
In the film, there is an interview, and we follow for a few days an architect who doesn't have an office. His office is always on the street markets where a lot of people comes during the weekend. This is kind of risky, thinking about making your office, making your way of living in that way. But actually, this architect, he was one of the exponents of the Biennale of Venice in 2016.
Yes.
He has more than 600 houses built, and he makes a good way of living through charging $2.50 per consult. Yeah, each consult that somebody wants to make him, he charges $2.50. And if you want him to visit your building site, then the amount is $7.
And he has 600 houses, so he's doing quite well. That adds up.
He's doing really well. And he's teaching his approach to architecture in a master. So there are several students who are taking the same business model to approach architecture. Because in the end, it's also a way of living by yourself without going and work for a big enterprise or for a big firm or for a great architect. So you are your own boss and you don't have to pay a lot of rent for having this office.
What is his name?
The name of the office is Gavi.
Gavi.
C-A-V-I. And his name is David Torres. David Mora Torres.
Your second film was called Architecture on the Edge, about Chilean architecture near you. And who were some of the architects that you covered in that?
We covered some of the most known architects here in Chile, for sure, Matias Klotz. There was also another building we covered that was made by Ryu Nishizawa, which is a Pritzker Prize winner architect from Japan.
Yes.
I think those are the most famous they were portrayed in this series.
Is the Chilean government investing more in modern buildings, or are they building more traditional kind of buildings for the federales?
It's not the same scenario than Mexico. There are a few investments in really good buildings, but most of them, they come from the private sector, not from the public one.
Okay. And the main industries in Chile, I know that the travel sector has been picking up quite a lot. More and more people are taking holiday in Chile.
Yeah, actually, holidays in Chile, they are quite expensive. If you want to relate this with the incomes of the society here in Chile, and yes, the Patagonia, Antarctica, it's a great place to be on holidays, because in Chile, you can have always the feeling that you are the first one entering this town. You are the first one walking through these fields or through these mountains or through these lakes. Maybe the surroundings are as good as in other country, but the feeling makes the difference. You have this feeling. You are the first one entering this boat.
Wow. That sounds wonderful. Now, your third film is called Here Are the Architectas, about women architects out of Mexico. Who are these women?
We usually try to know what is going on in different countries. And it happened that out of nowhere, every time we see what is going on in Mexico, between the first 10 names of big and more successful architectural firms, there were always five firms that were run by women. This is something strange. It doesn't happen in Spain. It doesn't happen in Chile. I don't know if in states between the top 10, there are 5 women. It doesn't happen so often. So we thought this could be a nice way of knowing why is this happening in Mexico. The architects we choose, they were Fernanda Canales, Tatiana Bilbao, and Rosana Montiel. Each of those women has her office, and her office is her own name.
So her own name, yes.
It's not a woman together with a man. No, it's just they by themselves.
Were there particular aspects of leadership in architecture that you discovered among these firms?
Yes, because all those 3 offices, they are run in a very different way. And what we thought it was really interesting, although it's not so well portrayed in the documentary, it's the way, not only how they design the buildings, but also how they design their own office, their own workflow. So, for instance, Fernanda Canales works by herself with no more people. So she designs everything, every single detail, every single line. By the other hand, you have Rosana Montiel, who works more or less in an office of 5 to 10 people, which all of them are women. And then you have the big part of it, which is Tatiana Bilbao. She runs an office of 2 or 3 floors with more than 30 people working in. And she has a structure where she's not only leading the projects, there are other women leading different parts of the office, which are as important as the projects by itself. Like, for instance, her sister, who is leading with all the financial stuff of an office, and another worker, Soledad Rodriguez, who takes care that everything they are building, it will stay the same way as it was designed in the beginning.
You mean for renovations and things?
No. Also new buildings, renovations. Tatiana Bilbao, she works abroad. She works in Spain. She works in France. She worked also in the States. It's a huge office.
In the United States, many of the firms that are run by men have a work ethic of working long hours and weekends. And a number of the women-owned firms don't do that. They seem to be able to go home at 5 or 6 o'clock and still get all the work done. Did you observe that as well in Mexico?
No, I haven't observed this. I think we as an architect, we are not well-trained in the schools, because in the schools, like the cool thing is to stay awake during the whole night and then enter your work or your competition the next day without any sleeping hour. And somehow we go on in our lives with this kind of workflow.
I would think there would be more and more interest of what we would call the work-life balance, of figuring out how to make greater efficiencies during the daytime so you could go home for dinner at a reasonable hour.
We have seen this is in the documentary in Ecuador, which is called Do More With Less, which is also on the Shelter platform. One of the big firms of Ecuador, which is called Al Borde, they work only from Monday to Thursday. So every Friday is for free. And they also eat together and they cook together. So they have a more sustainable way of living in terms of hours, in terms also of spending money. Because if you go and work for an office, then you have to eat something nearby, maybe a sandwich, and it's not so healthy. So they cook healthy food, they stay together, and they keep these long weekends.
And you've done a documentary about them?
Yes.
Oh, that's wonderful. I want to see that one too.
Yeah, it was our first one, and we still think it was the best one we did. I don't know why, but we are trying to find out why.
Many of our listeners are unfamiliar with Shelter as a streaming service because it's based in Australia. So tell them about it and how it works and how it works for you as a production house.
For us as a production house, it works quite good because we could develop several projects for them, and it means we didn't have to work a lot to raise money to make the production. So it's a private investment coming from Shelter. By the other hand, it's a nice platform because it works like Netflix. It doesn't have this amount of titles, of course, but it is a really nice platform where you can be subscribed for, let's say, 2 to 3 months every year. Because nowadays you have to be subscribed to all the newspapers and so on. So
yes,
there are a lot of subscription, and it's a really interesting platform to be subscribed for 2 months in a year. Because architecture for the main public, it's like passing by in the city and saying, oh, I like this building, I don't like this building. And that's it. And maybe also through a picture, no? So what movies or what documentary do in this respect is telling a little bit why this building is like this, why it has this shape, what were the conditions at the beginning of the project. So finally, people can like or dislike a project, but they know a little bit more of the reasons why this look in the way it looks.
It's really good that the shelter will help you by putting up some of the production costs in the beginning, because I know how hard it is to do documentaries on your own and then try to sell them afterwards.
It's almost impossible. So
yes.
Or you are depending all the time from public funds, which doesn't make this sustainable at all. I mean, the things work when you reach a wider audience. And the way you reach a wider audience, it can be through a streaming platform, for instance.
What is your favorite scene? And here are the Architecas.
The days we spent at the Fernanda Canales house, the first of the houses that is called the Terreno house. It's this house made with bricks with a lot of different patios. And all the time I placed the camera on a tripod, it was well composed. So I didn't make any effort or anything good. So the house was working perfectly to point the camera towards a wall, towards the ceiling, towards the floor. I discovered in this house another way of designing architecture. And she tells a little bit about it, because we always teach to design architecture like in a plan and having all these lines working perfectly one with another. But finally, this is not the experience we have when we walk through a building. So she made this effort, and you can see that the house in a plan, it looks like weird because sometimes it has some walls that are a little bit shifted and you say, oh, may this be a mistake? No, it's not a mistake. It's a way of trying that people who will pass by this wall will have a different feeling as if the wall will be straight.
The film is Here Are the Architecas. Thank you so much for talking with me, Mario.
Thanks to you for your time and your interest.
Please give my best to Katerina.
We'll do so.
Next week, starting in New York, the 2024 Architecture and Design Film Festival, or ADFF, rolls out the latest documentaries. I'm headed up there, too, to see films and interview filmmakers for future podcasts. With us now to talk about it, ADFF's founder and director, Kyle Bergman. Welcome, Kyle.
George, how are you? Good to talk to you again.
Oh, yeah. It is always great to have you back on the show, and you've got a wonderful lineup for this year. What's cooking?
Oh, my God. I may say this every year, but I think this is our best lineup ever. It is. I'm still amazed that so many amazing films come through the pipeline each year. And this year, we have so many world premieres and U.S. premieres. Tell you about the opening night film in New York. It's going to be the world premiere of Stardust. And it's a film by Jim Venturi about his folks, Denise Scott Brown and Robert Venturi. And it is just really sets the table for these two architects. Obviously, Bob is not alive anymore, and Denise is still alive, but towards the end of her life. And it's just a fun film. Jim is fun, who made it. And it really tells their story in a complete way that I think everyone who thinks they know the complete Bob and Denise story needs to see this. It is super fun.
And where is it going to be headquartered this year? Where will people see these films in New York?
It's September 25 through 28, and it's at the Angelica in the East Village. So the Angelica, during the pandemic, where many movie theaters closed down, the Angelica went for it and bought a couple of new theaters. So they have now 3 theaters in New York, and it's 2nd Avenue and 12th Street in the East Village. And so the world premiere is going to be an amazing amount of people and interest about the film. Martin Filler is going to be on the panel with Jim Venturi, and it should be a super exciting screening.
This is the 15th year of the festival?
16th, but you know, it still feels fresh every year when we come to it. So when we get to 20, we'll see what happens with it. But it's really been quite a long time doing it now.
Yeah.
I mean, and we've been talking about this for 8 or 9 or 10 yes. years almost.
Oh, yes. It's a highlight of my year.
Oh, my. Well, that's nice of you to say. Some other films that connect with modernism. We have a world premiere of a film called Schindler Space Architecture by Rudolf Schindler. A filmmaker has been working on her film for many, many years, almost a decade. And it really is the definitive film on Schindler. Like, you know, some people say in LA for architects, you're either Neutra or Schindler. And I think this really kind of hones in what it means to be Schindler.
Team Schindler. Okay.
Yeah, sorry. Some people are switch hitters, but like Frank Gehry is definitely Team Schindler.
Yeah.
And he talks about in the film when he was in school that Schindler was the one really inspired him to kind of go in the eventual direction that he went into. Let's see. Other modernist films is film about Carlo Scarpa called The Pavilion on the Water. And it is a Italian-made film. It's been playing for a year all over Italy. This will be its U.S. premiere. And it looks at the Brioni tomb, Carlo Scarpa's very famous tomb that he did north of Venice. But it also compares it to Japanese temples, and it's just an amazing film. Also a film that they've been working on for 10 years.
One of the things that I discovered in attending Kyle's Architecture and Design Film Festival was Doritos popcorn dust, which you have at theaters. I'd never seen it before. And you can sprinkle this Doritos dust on your popcorn. It's like having, you know, a festival in your mouth, really. Available at the Angelica Theater.
Definitely, we don't pick the theater just for that reason, but it's part of, you know, it definitely sways us, moves us in that direction. We're trying to get them to serve really nice mezcal, and that would then be the perfect combination, I think.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
We're not there yet with the mezcal, but we're working on it. Let's see, what else should we talk about? So there's a nice film called Sitting Still. It's also a world premiere. Mm-hmm. It's about the landscape architect, Laurie Olin, and his work he's done all throughout. He's done work in Central Park. He did Columbus Circle. He did Bryant Park in New York City. He did the landscape architecture at Grace Farms. And very modern. It's not modernist per se, but it's very modern, the landscape and his thinking. He's an amazing human and a great landscape designer and urbanist.
Not many films about landscape architecture, so I'm glad to see this one has been made.
No, it's really nice to see. So we also have a super special film. This is a film made by Jake Gorse. He's made a number of films that we've had at the festival over the years. And this is called New England Modernism, Revolutionary Architecture in the 20th Century. And it is a fantastic film. It's a survey film of modernism in New England. And it just covers so many buildings. Jake, when he makes his films, he is thorough, and just covers so many buildings. And he's got great interviews. He's got people from very, very important people talking about modernism. And he's got this guy from North Carolina in there, George Smart, who's does a great job talking, actually really setting the stage for the film. And you do a great job in there, George.
I like the way you frame that, Kyle. There's some very, very important people. And then George in the film. Okay.
No, setting it's the exclamation point. And yes. George, you really, your voice is in there, and you're kind of the baseline in a lot of these. And I'm sure you've seen Rough Cuts.
I saw the film in Palm Springs at a private screening. And one of the things I liked about the film is that even though I think I know a lot of modernist houses, there were so many I had never even seen before scattered about New England.
Yeah.
I mean, particularly north of the usual places like New York and Connecticut. You know, you're talking in New Hampshire and Vermont and Maine. It's just fascinating.
I think both the state historians from Maine and Vermont who are interviewed in there are really great and really give a great perspective on some of the buildings in their states that they know so well.
Cool.
And it ends with this architect named Dave Sellers, who is a Vermont architect. Mm-hmm. And Dave is actually the first architect I ever worked for and an old friend of mine and a crazy, interesting, very dynamic architect.
Well, this sounds like a wonderful lineup, Kyle. Where can people go to get tickets?
You can get tickets at our website, which is adfilmfest.com. We will be in New York. And George, hopefully you're going to be there visiting us.
Yes, I will.
Which will be in September. And then after that, we take the festival to Toronto in October 23rd through 26th. And then Vancouver, which is November 6th through 10th. And then down to LA, November 19th through 23rd. We take a little break. And then we are going to go to Mumbai this year in January.
Ah.
Also, one other special screening we're doing is going to be on October 10th. And it's going to be at the Four Freedoms Park in New York, the park designed by Lou Kahn. We're going to do a special screening of My Architect, which will be 20 years old and 50 years since the death of Lou Kahn. So that's going to be a really fun outdoor screening on October 10th in New York.
I'm going to have to figure out how to attend that. I want to come.
Oh my God, it's going to be so fun. And Nathaniel will be there and a couple of other special guests. So we're really looking forward to that.
This is great, Kyle. Thank you so much for coming back on the show and sharing with us the highlights for this year. And everybody head up to New York and see these films.
Thanks, George. And we're looking forward to seeing you in some more films. I mean, Paul Goldberger is in a lot of films. And now I think in the modernist films, people should start looking towards you as someone who can comment on and also talk about modernism in all sorts of different places.
Well, thank you. I'll tell my agent.
Okay, great. Take care, George.
Lucie Arnaz was born into show business. The daughter of Lucille Ball and Desi Arnaz, with an acting career which began on The Lucy Show with her mother and continued with The Lucie Arnaz Show and later the critically acclaimed Sons and Daughters. With films including The Jazz Singer, Billy Jack Goes to Washington, which never made it to theaters, Second Thoughts and Down to You, she's married to Spock's half-brother from the Star Trek movies, actor Lawrence Luckinbill, who I remember from a wonderful TV series from the 70s called The Delphi Bureau, which was fantastic. And before that, he was my grandmother's favorite actor in The Secret Storm, which really takes you back a couple of years. Lucy's latest album is Live at the Purple Room, and the name of her cabaret show touring the country, including the actual Purple Room in Palm Springs, is How I Got the Job. She is the perfect convergence of the three things I love most: jazz, architecture, and Star Trek. Welcome, Lucy.
I love that I have been spread into all those areas. That's great. That is true, though.
Yeah, I know, because before we talk about architecture or music, you have so many connections to Star Trek, the original series, because your parents produced it, didn't they, in their studio?
Yeah, Desilu Productions, the studio, was the first place that they made the pilot, and then they made the series there. As the myth goes, it was for my mother. If it wasn't for my mother, the show would have made it. Well, yeah. There's some truth to that, and it's a little more complicated. My father had already sort of bought the idea, and then he left the studio. My mother bought him out, and so that idea was floating around there, and then they made the pilot, and then they were going to cancel it because it was too expensive. And they thought the suits, when my mother had to take over, were telling her Mission Impossible, Star Trek, Mannix, they all have to go. They're too expensive. And she said, well, and her next husband, my stepfather, was Gary Morton.
Right.
And she said, well, Gary likes them. He likes Star Trek. He likes Mission Impossible. I think we should keep those. So they kept them. So actually, we ought to give Gary Morton a little credit for that too. You know, he doesn't get credit for much. Let's give him credit for that. But yeah, it had to do. It was filmed at Desilu, and they were responsible for creating the show originally. And yeah, it's pretty amazing because then I ended up marrying Larry, who a few years after we were married, played Spock's brother, Cybok, in Star Trek V. And this happens to be the 35th anniversary of Star Trek V this year.
Oh, wow. Okay, cool. Cool, cool.
And it coincided with Larry writing his own autobiography. He wrote an autobiography. It's taken him the last decade on and off. It's called Affective Memories, How Chance in the Theater Saved My Life. And he does a long, as you can imagine, couple of chapters about Star Trek in there and Boys in the Band and all the movies he's made and Delphi Bureau and all those things. But it ended up coming out the same year as Star Trek V's 35th anniversary. So we just got back from Vegas and this big Trekkie convention, which I had never gone to. That was an experience.
I bet it was.
I wasn't dressed properly.
You didn't have on your Vulcan ears.
I stood out like a sore thumb at that, like just looking normal, like with a baseball cap on my head. It was exciting, and they celebrated him and the whole cast and his book. And so it was really nice, very nice for Larry. And it's a terrific read. It's a wonderful book. It's available all over the place. So,
and a lot of people don't know that your parent studio eventually became Paramount, right?
Yes, it was RKO. They bought RKO, which is interesting because that was the studio they both met at and started their careers. And then when they needed to get their production company bigger so they could compete with the networks, which are getting, were getting into television, the studio became available and they put out an offer and they were able to sell their half of I Love Lucy back to CBS. And with the cash they got from that, they bought RKO Studios and turned it into Desilu Studios, which became the largest television production company in the world for a while there. So, you know, if you look back on it, you want to go, wait a minute. Did you have to sell your half of I Love Lucy in order to do that? Because if I was a little older at the time, I would have said, wait, whoa. But it was one of those things, right? It seemed like a good idea at the time.
At the time. Yeah. Those series, Star Trek, Mission Impossible, Mannix, were all really iconic series of that era. And two of them have franchises that are still going strong today.
It's fantastic. Bill Shatner and Tom Cruise, they owe all their homes and boats and planes to that. Those shows. I know. It's true.
Now, you have a big connection to architecture as well. Your parents commissioned, I think, a couple of modernist houses, right? One by Paul Williams. And was there another one by Donald Wexler?
No.
Or something in Chatsworth? Tell me about your...
No, that's an interesting story that I didn't find out until only a few years ago. The house that they bought in Chatsworth, California, there was nothing but empty land and a few orange groves. And they bought this little ranchita that didn't even have a fence around it. It was just kind of bare land and a basic house. But the house was great. It was a couple of acres, several acres. And there was plenty of room to put in a pool, which my dad rented a tractor and dug himself. And, you know, it was amazing what they did and put in gardens and orchards and a barbecue and grape arbors. It was fabulous. But they later moved to Beverly Hills to be closer to the studio because they had to go back and forth so often. It was just taking too much time.
Yeah.
And when they got to be a little bit more famous in I Love Lucy, it was 1954. They had been vacationing to Palm Springs a lot on the weekends and before they were married, and they wanted to build a house here. So they said, who built that great ranchito house that we bought in Chatsworth? And they found out it was architecturally designed by Paul Revere Williams.
Yes.
And his claim to fame, as most people would know, he was the first Black architect who was allowed into the Architectural Society, you know,
the AIA, first AIA, right, yeah.
Yeah, and he was an amazing person. He had designed that house, among others, and, you know, the Los Angeles Airport and Saks Fifth Avenue or whatever, all kinds of eclectic buildings all over the place. And one of the things I always thought was so cool about that guy, I learned that he learned how to draw his designs upside down because he wanted to sit across from people and show them what he saw for their house. But he had to learn to draw it facing them like upside down because white people didn't want to sit next to Black people.
Yes.
So he had to draw upside
Famous
down.
Famous story of Paul Williams.
He could sit across the table. Kills me. What people have to do, oh my gosh, to think that we actually lived through a period of time where that was a necessity is crazy. But they found out it was Paul Williams, and so they hired him to design the house for Palm Springs. And he designed this wonderful mid-century, you know, expanded one-level house that just floated in sort of a semicircle on the 17th fairway overlooking the mountains up on a little hill. It's a perfect spot. And the pictures that I still, I mean, I was at the house my whole life. So I grew up there from the time I was like 4 and a half. And then my mother, after she passed away, my stepfather, Gary Morton, lived there and he remarried. And Susie McAllister Morton, his wife, his widow now, still lives there. She changed it up a lot. When Gary got it himself, he renovated, like, which was good. You know, I mean, carpets and stuff like that. But then when Susie came in, they knocked out some of the walls and they changed it. It's very beautiful what they did. You know, it's, oh, that's pretty. And oh, look at that. But it was all the sort of decor of the 90s, you know, the late 80s and the 90s. And little by little, the whole mid-century modern feel got taken away, especially in the backyard and the pool and the patio and the bedrooms and the living room. And now it's all sort of trendy, you know, the way they build these big tract housey type things.
Right.
The only time it really feels like it's still the same house is when you're in the front of it. The front of the house still looks the same, which is nice. But it was a gorgeous house. I wish it still looked the way it looked, but, you know, they didn't care. It's the best thing I can say.
Here's Lucie with a song from her latest album, Live at the Purple Room. Nice work if you can get it.
The man who only lives for making money lives a life that isn't necessarily sunny. Likewise, the man who works for fame, there's no guarantee that time won't erase his name. The fact is, the only work that really brings enjoyment is the kind that is for girl and boy meant. Fall in love, he won't regret it. That's the best work of all, if you can get it. Holding hands at midnight, 'neath a starry sky. Nice work if you can get it, and you can get it if you try. Strolling with a one boy, sighing sigh after sigh. Nice work if you can get it, and you can get it if you try. Just imagine someone waiting at the cottage door, where two hearts become one. Who could ask for anything more? Loving one who loves you, and then taking that vow. Nice work if you can get it, and if you get it, won't you tell me? That vow. Nice work if you can get it, and if you get it, then won't you tell me how?
You know, Lucie, that song really does have legs. I mean, it just, every time somebody covers it for a new time, it's nice to be able to inject that personal energy into it like you do.
One of the things I like the best, thank you for saying that. One of the things I really like the best about working with my musical director, Ron Abel, is that he takes songs that you've heard a zillion times and you love them, and he finds a way to breathe some new life, some new energy, some new thought process in the arrangement, so that it doesn't sound exactly like you think it's going to. And nice work if you can get it in this particular instance was one of those things. I tell a story in the show about going up on my lines and forgetting what song was coming up, and they started the musical cue, and I was like, I have no idea what comes up right now. I was so lost. And this was after doing my one and only, the Broadway show, for 7 months on the road, you know. And so you know what you're doing. You know all your lines backwards and forwards, and that's when it gets a little dangerous, because you're out there, you think you know what you're doing. And so your mind wanders just a little tiny bit, you know, and then all of a sudden you go, whoa, where am I? And so there's a very funny story that I tell prior to this. And then I say, all right, Ron, let's see if we can do a version of this song that's not going to horrify the Gershwins, you know, because I screwed it up so bad in the show. And then he wrote this really kind of bluesy middle of the night, 3 o'clock in the morning at the bar, where she's really trying to figure it out. And it's when you take a different arrangement set, it makes you go back and then you apply that feeling to every single lyric. And it's amazing how it grows and matures and changes, because I have certainly since I did that play all those years ago. It was 9 years ago, ridiculous. And there's a whole other song in there somewhere. You know, there's this desperate woman who's heard everybody tell her that it's so easy. Just fall in love. You won't regret it. That's the best work of all, if you can get it.
If you can get it, yeah.
And if you get it, tell me how you did that. You know, I mean, it's like, she's not like, won't you tell me how? Yeah, it doesn't have to be like that. He wrote an arrangement that's on my first album called Just in Time, but he wrote an arrangement on that album to Blue Skies. Mm-hmm. Now, Blue Skies, every time you hear it from all the greats, you know, it's like Blue Skies, Irving Berlin, right?
Right.
Well, I did a whole tribute show to Irving Berlin on his 100th birthday years ago, and Ron took that song and turned it into this ethereal levitation of those lyrics that is so optimistically beautiful and also kind of dark, like you're praying, you're using a manifestation, you're looking and hoping for blue skies.
Yeah.
Like this is kind of where we are right now on the planet, right? You're saying, this is my meditation, blue skies, you know, smiling at me, nothing but blue skies do I see, bluebirds. So you rethink, what are you saying? It's not just about the rhythm. It's not about the finger snapping jazzy. There's always a message. There's always a story. And that's what I love about the great composers and the great lyricists, what they give us to work with, you know?
Well, let's hear this second song. This is from the play Pippin that you appeared in. Really fun song called No Time at All.
When you are as old as I, my dears, and I hope that I'm there when you are, you will woefully wonder why, my dear, through your cataracts and catarrh, you could squander away or sequester a drop of a precious year. For when your best days are yester, the rest are twice as dear. Listen up. What good is a field on a fine summer night if you sit all alone with the weeds, or a succulent pear if with each juicy bite you spit out your teeth with the seeds? Before it's too late, stop trying to wait for fortune and fate you're secure of. For there's one thing to be sure of, mate, there's nothing to be sure of. It's time to start living, time to take a little from the world you're given, time to take time, for spring will turn to fall in just no time at all. Now I never wondered if I was afraid when there was a challenge to take. And I never thought about how much I weighed if there was still one piece of cake. Maybe it's meant the hours I've spent feeling broken and bent and unwell, but there's still no cure so heaven sent as a chance to raise some hell. Oh, it's time to start living. Time to take a little from the world you're given. Time to take time, 'cause spring will turn to fall in just no time at all. So when those drearies do attack and a siege of the sads begins, I throw these regal shoulders back and lift these noble chins. Here is a secret I never have told. Maybe you'll understand why. I believe if I refuse to grow old, that I can stay young till I die. Now, I've known the fears of 70 years. I've had troubles and tears by the score. But the only thing that I'd trade them for is 71 more. Oh, it's time to start living. Time to keep taking from the world you're given. Time to take time, for spring will turn to fall. And watching your flings be flung all over makes me feel young all over in just no time at all.
Lucie, that is a great play. And of course, it's been done a lot since then. Such high energy. I understand that you had to do some sort of trapeze work in that play.
A new version of Pippin that was on Broadway in 2013-14 had a whole kind of Cirque du Soleil effect with a lot of acrobats and, you know, high wire stuff and silks and trapeze and fantastic stuff. That was the new take on this sort of circus comes to town Pippin thing. Yeah. And I was asked to do the First National tour and play Grandma Bertha on the tour. And I was a Tony voter for 15 years. So I saw that show. I saw all these shows. And I remember saying, oh my God, how did she ever learn to do that? That woman is almost 70, you know, what? And it's not a flying trapeze. It's a trapeze that goes up high on a bar and you're with one acrobat. And then during it, you stand up and you cross and you sit down and you fall over, you know, you hang upside down. And then he holds you just by your pelvis and your legs are out and your arms are flying. And but there's no net, there's no wires, there's nothing. You're just way high above the stage. It's phenomenal. And it comes right in the middle of the song. So it was an amazing challenge, needless to say, to learn how to do that. And she gets to do it while she's singing this amazing song. She sings part of it on the ground and then they woo, then they go up and she sings the rest of it. But the song itself is just such a great message that I loved leaving to the audiences we played to across the country. It's a wonderful thing to say about time and how little of it there really is. And you have to make the most of it, you know, because as the lyric says, you know, spring will turn to fall and just no time at all, as we know.
For our listeners who've never been to the Purple Room, which you've played many times and recorded your album there, describe what it's like to go into this place. I mean, first of all, it is a little hard to find because you think it's a hotel. You don't quite realize that the Purple Room is in there unless you look really closely.
Yes, it's in the same location that it has been in its entire existence. And back in the 60s, when Sinatra lived 10 minutes away in Rancho Mirage, it was famous for being sort of a dive, a bar. It was the musicians that got up and played whatever in the corner, and it was like itty bitty stage, piano and whatnot. So it was a piano bar, you know, it was like a real dive.
Yeah.
It's in this hotel called the Club Trinidad, which is a motel, a stinky motel. No, a lovely motel. I'm sorry. How dare I say that? It's a divine motel. But in the front of the motel, as you go into the lobby, there's a little offshoot room, which I'm sure back in the day was just come in there and get a beer, you know. But it has a kitchen and it has this beautiful front area, back area. And Michael Holmes, who now owns the Purple Room space, he turned it into the most elegant, lovely supper club, like you remember your grandparents talking about in the 40s, mm-hmm. you know, like just like Ciro's. It's the Mocambo, you know, it's a fabulous place. And it's tablecloths and these beautiful little, you know, lanterns on the table and a great bar and a beautiful stage with fantastic lighting and beautiful sound. And everybody who's anybody has played there because it has this reputation of Sinatra going back down with his buddies, you know, Dean and Sammy and Peter Lawford and whoever wanted to get up when they got kicked out of wherever else they were. And they, sure. let's go to the Purple. And then they'd go down there and somebody would, you know, Sammy Kahn would get to the piano and they would stay up till 4 a.m, hanging and singing and drinking and having fun. So it has a history, but now it's creating its own history because it's a beautiful place to eat, first of all.
Yes,
it's a wonderful restaurant.
I've been there.
Wonderful restaurant. You don't have to come and see the show. You can just go and eat. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and some Thursdays, it just has nice, beautiful, fun standards and jazz and the local, you know, like the stuff that's there every week. While you eat dinner, there's wonderful music. And then Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or sometimes Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, there's the people that come in and play the club, like myself, like mm-hmm. Billy Stritch, Anne Hampton Calloway, you know, Ben Jones, everybody has played there. Except Sunday nights, usually there's Michael Holmes does this just hilarious, wonderful show, has such fun with the Judy Garland impersonation. He's like 7 feet tall, and then he puts on my old heels, and he's Judy Garland, but it's not a drag show. It's almost like a stand-up comic, and he does 3 and 4 different impressions, Pearl Bailey, Betty Davis, Judy. But Judy is like the host of the evening, and so Sunday nights, it's Judy's show at the Purple Room, and you cannot get a ticket unless you book like 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks in advance. So the place is pretty popular, and I was honored that he allowed me to tape my show the 2 nights I was there and use that as a live recording. It's a thrill and a half for me.
Who was the guy that your mother befriended who did female impersonations and was on TV? I think he was the first one.
Jim Bailey.
On TV, yeah.
Jim Bailey.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, Jim. Jim was a good friend of all of ours, great friend of mine. And I hung out with him everywhere. I used to travel all over the country to see his shows. I was so impressed with his talent because, you know, yes, he did an amazing, like eerie, my mother used to call it, eerie representation of Judy and Barbara and Peggy Lee. Mm-hmm. But he wasn't sending it up in any term. It wasn't like these impersonators, you know, who send it up a little bit. Even right. if Michael Holmes, he's sending up Judy like crazy. It's not right. legit. It's for fun. But Jim, he became those people. And I mean, even in the dressing room before the show, like he'd be changing out of Jim Bailey and becoming Judy Garland, putting the makeup on and the whatever. And I could see there was this point where I really felt I had to leave the room.
Yeah.
Because he became someone else. And I felt weird talking to Judy. talking
and he to was Barbara. Really the pioneer, wasn't he? He was the first one on TV and to get a national kind of following.
For that kind of talent, yes. Not for there were guys. Listen, Milton Berle was dressing up in drag, you know,
right,
doing comedy and stuff. And I'm sure there was another. I'm trying to remember the name of the other sort of famous Charles Pierce and all these people who would do different Charles Bush. And but I don't know when they started. Jim was in a league of his own, and plus he had a voice that was outrageous. He has a couple of albums. If anybody can ever find them. One album in particular, when I was hanging with him, one side is all Jim Bailey just singing as himself, and the other side is Judy and Barbara and all the characters. And it's a magnificent, I Capricorn is, I think, the name of the album.
Okay.
Anyway, I was fortunate to have a chance to get to know him and appreciate that incredible talent.
Well, Lucie, this has been really fun talking to you. Thank you so much. Her latest album is Live at the Purple Room. Lucie, live long and prosper.
Oh, you can do that. Live
long and prosper. I'm giving her the signal.
I know, right? I have to glue my fingers together.
That's been fun.
Thank you, George.
Thanks for listening. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by June Goldfinger and Jeff Taylor, sponsors of Circle Square Triangle, a traveling exhibition on the architecture of Myron Goldfinger, and by Diane Bald and the Budman Family,
restoring significant architecture in Toronto, Malibu, Los Angeles, and Palm Springs.
Visit usmodernist.org's massive archives to listen to past shows, discover documentation of 22,000 significant modernist houses, and access 4.3 million pages of classic 20th century architecture magazines. U.S. Modernist Radio is produced by Soundtracks Recording Studios in Raleigh, North Carolina. Our theme song is performed by George Smart and Robinson Earle, with guest research by archivist Kelly Policelli. U.S. Modernist Radio is a production of Modernist Archive Incorporated, a nonprofit educational archive for the documentation, preservation, and promotion of modernist residential design. I'm Tom Guild. George and I'll be back soon with another Let's Go to the Movies edition of U.S. Modernist Radio.
Then do we get to go to a snack bar afterwards?
I hope so.